Good morning this day, and welcome in the name of our Lord Christ. Welcome to this service of worship. It is good to see you and to be together. God has blessed us with the opportunity to share in worship. A couple of announcements. First of all, let me ask you to find the attendance registers on the inside aisle end of the pew. If you can pass those along, we'll have a record of who is worshiping with us. Also note that you can check a box to let us know that you're going to join us for Wednesday dinners during the Advent season. Today is Christ the King Sunday, which turns out to be the last Sunday in the liturgical year. Everything we've talked about all year long leads us to the point of saying Christ is King. And then next Sunday begins Advent, which is the beginning of the liturgical season leading up, of course, to Christmas. And we will be having Wednesday night dinners beginning December 2nd. So if you can be with us for that, check that box as the pew pad comes along. If you're sitting here today, and others who maybe will watch this or hear it on the web page, if you're here, then you are a part of this church, and we want to hear from you, the things that you have on your mind. There is, following worship today, the elder in the parlor, our elder of the week is Jim Harris, and we do want you to let us know through that avenue things that are on your mind, things that you'd like for the rest of us to know, things that you'd like for us to follow through on. As I said, next week begins Advent, that great season of the year which helps us to prepare for the coming of Christ, all the different ways that Christ comes to us, not just as a baby in a manger in Bethlehem, but also comes to our hearts and minds as a source of strength and faith. Wednesday night dinners do begin on December 2nd. One piece of extremely good news, and that is that Leslie Kirkconnell is going to be joining us as our Christian educator in January. Many of you had a chance to meet her last weekend. Was that just last weekend? I think so. She was here with us visiting, and she has accepted our invitation to come. Leslie has a good career as a Christian educator. She is a graduate of Maryville College in Tennessee and also the Presbyterian School of Christian Education. She is a certified Christian educator, which is an elaborate process in the Presbyterian Church to become certified. And we are very, very fortunate to have her and her husband, Glenn. They will be joining us in January. Also following worship today, not only is Jim Harris in the parlor, but also down in the fellowship hall, we will have an opportunity to sign up for some of the fellowship opportunities that are in the bulletin today. Please think about that, and you'll see a table, in fact, two tables, where you can sign up to be involved in one or more of those fellowship opportunities. We are a church that works together and worships together, and we also want, through these fellowship chances, to enjoy one another together. God has blessed us and called us here. Let us worship God.
is calling us to worship. Jesus, Savior, guide our steps, because you are the way.
Jesus, Savior, help us.
Jesus, Healer, bring your balm, for you are the life.
Celebration. Indeed, Christ is King. We celebrate the King's mercy as we lay down the burden of our sin to Him. Join me in the unison prayer of adoration and confession. Lord, your love is demonstrated in life, death, and resurrection of Christ our King. May the shades of my love continue to rule in our hearts. God is willing to cleanse us from our pride, our blindness, our stubborn insistence on having things our way. Through God's grace, we are washed and forgiven.
Amen.
who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here in this safe and sacred place. So let us greet one another as a sign of God's peace, and the peace of Christ be with you. And let us share that.
All right, and let me invite the children who are present, if you'll join me on the steps for just a moment. Don't be afraid, right? We have these wonderful, reasonable children, and you can look in their faces and see what is he up to now, you know. So it goes. Well, have you ever noticed how sometimes people get words confused? Maybe you're saying something and you mumble it or something, or someone else mumbles a word and you don't quite hear it and you don't know what they said. Does that ever happen? Sometimes it does. There are a couple of funny church-related things like that. Some people, I understand, have sung the Christmas hymn, "Hark the Herald Angels Sing," and it made them think that the angel was named Harold. See, "Hark the Herald Angel Sings." And then there are some people who think the first line in the Lord's Prayer is really a question. "Our Father who art in heaven, how do you know my name?" Anyway, so today I wanted to talk about the difference between crayon and crown, okay? Obviously, what I've got on my head is a set of crayons, all right. And people say that word differently. Some people say crayon, which does sound a little bit like crown. Some people say crayon. That's if you're from the Deep South. Some people say crayon. Anyway, Jesus is king, and Jesus doesn't wear a crown. Jesus is much more interested, I think, in what we can do, how we can add color to the life around us. And so Jesus doesn't wear a crown, but he may be interested in our using crayons or crayons to make our world more beautiful, and all the other things that we might be able to do to share in God's world. Jesus is our king, but he doesn't wear a crown. What are some things maybe that you can do in life that show that you belong to Jesus? Got any ideas? Helping others. Thank you, Benjamin. You're always good with those answers. Well, that pretty well says it. We try to help others. We try to be good to each other. We try to remember to say our prayers and many other things that are a part of belonging to Jesus. Jesus is a king, but he doesn't wear a crown. If you want, I will give you one of these crowns to take with you. I've got a few copies if you're interested. Are you interested? First of all, let's have a prayer. Lord, we thank you that you like crayons more than crowns, for indeed you're interested in what we can do, how we can use our own creativity to bring about the world that you want. Thank you for these children, for the love in their homes, and for your invitation to them to share that love widely. And these things we pray in Jesus' name, Jesus who is our King. Amen. You want one of these? You might as well. You know, I made them for you. You're good. Okay. Okay.
Lord, speak to us this Christ the King Sunday. Let your word be the source of new vision and fresh hope, and let us receive your word as the truth. By what is read, proclaimed, and heard, we want to be renewed. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. The prayer for illumination is a reading from Revelation. Grace to you and peace from him who is, who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God.
Thank you.
Our gospel reading for this Christ the King Sunday is taken from the 18th chapter of John's gospel. Pretty familiar story, Jesus being questioned by Pilate. Let us stand together for the reading of the gospel. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." And Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated. Well, I'm pretty sure that it's the unpredictability of children's sermons that make them popular the world round. Once a minister was trying to appeal to the kids by telling them a fable about frogs. "What's green and sits on a lily pad?" he asked them. And the children answered together, "Jesus." And the minister was determined to tell this fable, and so he says, "What lives in the water and sometimes sits on the bank and sticks out a long tongue to capture flies?" And the children said, "Jesus." The minister was beside himself with frustration. He asked the children, "Why do you keep shouting Jesus all the time?" And the children said, through one who served as a spokesman, he said, "You didn't bring us down here to talk about frogs." Today is Christ the King Sunday on the liturgical calendar. It's the day that we all get to say Jesus at the top of our lungs. Jesus is the Lord of all, everything, every agenda, every idea, every matter in heaven and on earth. All things are subordinate to the reign of Jesus Christ, as it was in the beginning, now and forever. Amen. Jesus is Lord. Well, too bad the Roman governor Pontius Pilate doesn't seem to think so. Pilate asks Jesus in a kind of distracted, bureaucratic fashion if he is in fact a king, and then he has him sent away to be beaten. The Jewish religious authorities don't seem to think Jesus is a king either. They see him as a threat to the religious status quo. Even Peter, the disciple and apostle, even Peter doesn't act as if he believes that Jesus is the king. After all, he will deny Jesus three times. Christ the King Sunday is the last Sunday in the liturgical year. We move from this day to the beginning of the story, Advent, with Advent waiting, leading up to Christmas and the birth of Jesus. And then there is a period we call Epiphany, which is a celebration of Jesus' ministry and particularly his healing. And then we think about his death on a cross during Lent and Holy Week. And then we have Easter. And then comes the coming of God's Holy Spirit during the season we call Pentecost. It's an entire year, and throughout the year we are thinking about how the Jesus event has meaning for us as Christians. A whole year arranged around the events of the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. So it is that the year rightly concludes with the resounding verdict of this day: Christ is King. Jesus is Lord. He reigns. He reigns. But, as we're observing, this verdict is not for everybody. We see it in the scriptures. Pilate, the religious authorities, even the Apostle Peter. And we observe it in real life, in our lives. People do choose not to follow Jesus. Other things get in the way, maybe, or become for us distractions. Other things seem a little more urgent to us. Other events keep us from seeing the importance of the big event, which is Jesus' life and teaching and his redeeming death and his saving resurrection and his promised presence to the end of the age. John Calvin has written that the human mind is a perpetual forge for idols, a perpetual forge for idols. It is, in fact, the most natural thing in the world for us to kind of make it up as we go along in our spiritual lives. We imagine that this or that thing may help us improve our lives, but then we forget the real thing, who is Jesus the Christ. I've always thought that the Roman governor Pilate is really kind of a stand-in in this story, a stand-in for many of us. Pilate is apparently pretty weary. He has a lot to do. The Roman authorities back in the Roman headquarters are breathing down his neck. There's not enough for him to do that is really stimulating and engaging. By and large, it seems that it's best for him just to sort of go with the flow. Tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day. And Pilate, like Macbeth, is indifferent to it all. He asks Jesus a couple of yawning questions, but his heart's not really in it. He asks, "So you are a king?" And he asks, "What is truth?" Ho-hum, ho-hum. We've all been there, haven't we? Make 3 copies and file. Or if we're not bored with things, then we are barraged and sensationalized with blood and guts all around. The bombs in Paris, Belgian jihadists, the obligatory retaliation, assassinating the perpetrators in their grubby little apartment. Returning violence for violence with what is apparently full international acceptance, it does seem cruel, doesn't it? But there's no other way. So maybe give this a chance. Christ the King Sunday really, truly is a chance for us to go in another way. The idols we forge, the sad and cynical things we've counted on, the lies we've told ourselves and listened to, the things that won't guide us, the fears that won't motivate us, the idols that our imaginations have forged. Maybe all of those things, so real as they seem, maybe they don't really pertain like we thought they did. Christ being king allows us to claim or reclaim a different allegiance. Things are never so blah and ordinary that they can't be changed and made better. Neither are things so desperate in this world that we have no other choice about violence and mayhem. The idols we forge prove themselves unworkable, as they typically, inevitably do, then the way remains open for us to embrace Jesus. Jesus Christ, who is the way and the truth and the life. Well, following Jesus is good, but it's not always safe. In fact, it might mean pushing against the tide of culture. It certainly means doing things differently, Jason Biasi, whose writing I admire, says that what Jesus holds up to us is about the beating of the heart of the universe. After all, Jesus is Lord. He has been there from the beginning. He will be there at the end. What he holds up to us is the beating heart of the universe. Love and justice and compassion that we see around Jesus and in his life tells us a final truth about existence and about God. Signing on to follow Jesus means committing ourselves to things that heal and things that bless. This really is something different. This is not the ordinary way of the world. Jesus even admits it. He says to Pilate, "My kingdom is not of this world." But still, he calls us to come and to follow along in his way. Jesus has an eternal truth, and he tells us this is right. This is the way and the truth and the life. The thing of which we must be convinced is that Jesus' way really is the best way. That the things we associate with Jesus, kindness, generosity, attention to others and their needs, even loving sacrifice for others, we have to convince ourselves that all of that really is life-giving. Is it life-giving? The Lord, the one who is at the very heart of the universe, says so. And the practice of the Christian faith through long centuries attests to it as well. Following Christ, listening for the Lord to speak, trying to live up to the promise of our baptisms is life. It's life, and it's life like no other. As I see it, we are experiencing a renaissance, a new birth, a new life in this church. I hope you felt that. Many of you have said to me that you feel a new energy, a new vitality somehow that we didn't have before. And I don't really have an answer for why that is. We certainly don't control that vitality in our church. But it just seems that in several ways we've gotten past some of the distractions of our own making and have started again to simply do what we as a church are called to do by Christ. The first indication of all of this, I think, was last year, last November, when we began to host the homeless in Room in the Inn. That project demands a lot of us. We had over 100 volunteers last year, and of course, Room in the Inn for us started up this past Thursday, so we're doing it again and glad to be doing it. That effort, Room in the Inn, has been invigorating for us. Also invigorating, I think, is the expressed intention to listen to one another more carefully. That's evidenced by having an elder of the week in the parlor each week so that we might come together and talk about things that are on our minds, common concerns. I think the move to having one church service each Sunday has been good for us. And I should say, and I mean this with all sincerity, we should offer, and they deserve great thanks, those people who are so wedded to the early service, so wanted to keep our 8:30 service. Those people have continued to come, and they have accepted this change with real grace. We thank them for that. It's part of the life of this church, that grace, that willingness to share. And I've also thought, and I should say, if you're feeling that resurgence in the life of this church, you're not the only one. I was with a group last week. We were meeting to pray for one another and for the church. And we had a visitor, not somebody who belongs to the church. In fact, it was somebody from Louisville that we're working with. And he said to us, without prompting, that he was amazed, sitting in the room with us, amazed to feel so surely that the Spirit is moving in this church. Jesus is Lord. He's not a good luck charm, not a rabbit's foot. He's not a fuzzy, lovable Christian mascot. He is good, but he's not safe. He reigns, and it is his will to carry us along with him toward God's rich fulfillment of all things. We didn't come this morning to talk about frogs, and we didn't really come to talk about our own progress as a church. No, we came to talk about how the Lord loves us and how the Lord is continually opening the ways for us to discover and enjoy eternal life. Apart from all the distractions and idols that we put in our own way, we are seeing the truth more clearly. O Christ, surround us. And thanks be to God this day. Amen. Let us all pray. Lord, we look around and we see things which frighten us or give us reason for concern, but we also see your hand guiding us, restoring our strength, giving us the help we need, calling from us our very best efforts. And so we pray, continue to bless us to move ever closer to you, you who are the life and the truth forever. O Christ, surround us. Amen. Affirmation of faith this week is taken again from a declaration of faith. It speaks to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Together, let us say what we believe. Hope in God gives us courage for the struggle. We know our efforts cannot bring in God's kingdom, but hope plunges us into the struggle for victories over evil that are possible now in the world, the church, and our individual lives. Hope gives us courage and energy to contend against all opposition, however invincible it may seem, for the new world and the new humanity that are surely coming. Jesus is Lord. He has been Lord from the beginning. He will be Lord at the end. Even now, He is Lord. Amen. And please be seated.
Let us pray. Gracious God, help all of us to receive this day as a gift. In our caution and in our confidence, teach us to listen for your voice and to watch for your provision. We give you thanks, gracious God, for this beautiful earth, for all of the forests and minerals, the waters and the wildlife, for our senses by which we hear inspiring music and see the sunsets and smell the fragrance of flowers and feel the softness of another's caress. For the laughter of children and the hugs of friends and the smile of a loved one and a friendly handshake on Sunday morning. Thank you for teachers, mentors, and heroes who have helped us in our journey. And for all those who will feed us this Thanksgiving week and who have graciously served us in the past. And thank you for those of our church and in our church will be served this Thursday. And thank you for a place we call home, for food that sustains us, for clothes that keep us warm, gracious God, for advances in medical research, the resilience of body and spirit, and your healing power, and for your comfort in our sorrows and grief, and for your mending in our brokenness, and for opportunities to start over in newness, for making us dependent on you, and even more for your being dependable, supplying all that we require, and more from your treasure stores of eternal mercy, for productive lives and creative expression and quiet moments. We pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, the reigning King, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The Advent Angel Tree allows our congregation to provide Christmas gifts for nearly 70 children from McNeil Elementary School. These are students who are on the free and reduced lunch program at McNeil. Next Sunday, the Advent season begins. The Angel Tree will be up before next week, so please look for it. We respond to God's blessings with thanksgiving. Our thanks is registered by the help we can offer others and by bringing our offerings together. Let us come before God now with our tithes and offerings.